Hello and welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is John Smith. I'm the co-campus pastor here at the Rolling Meadows campus, and I'm really glad you're here with us today. This is my wife, Sherry, and we've been married 29 years, and it's been so great. Most of those years, we've been able to enjoy doing ministry together.
Absolutely. In addition to being a pastor's wife, I also have the honor of serving on the communications team here at the church. Well, we would love to know where you're watching from today. You know, we know that we have family watching today from Ohio and from Arizona, but maybe you can put it in the comments or in the chat where you're watching from today. We're really glad you're here.
That's great. Can't wait to see if there's some people that are even on the other side of the pond checking in today. Well, parents and students, got some great news for you. We're going to be getting back in person for ministry really soon. So there's all sorts of information for you at harvestnow.info to let you know when your campus is going to be opening the in-person experience for our student ministry. I was talking to Pastor Heath this week, and he is so excited about getting these students back together and watching the Lord do great work in person.
Great. Well, at the end of our service today, we're going to remember the Lord and observe communion together as a church body. So maybe you're already prepared for that, and that would be great, but maybe you're not. And this is an opportunity right now before the service starts for you to grab some juice, get a cracker or a piece of bread. We would love to have you participate with us when we remember the Lord together.
You know, there's a couple ordinances that we get to observe as a church. Last week, we got to observe one of them. It's baptism. And we got to see someone who was lost, found, blind, but now they have sight because of salvation. And we got to hear their story of salvation. And that was such an encouragement to all of us. And this week, as a church, observing communion gives us a chance to reflect and remember all that Christ did for us on the cross. And so if you're a follower of Christ, we would invite you to be a part of our communion at the end of the service. You don't have to be a member. Just join in and celebrate the goodness and the greatness of Jesus Christ.
Well, as we continue our series, Teach Us to Pray, Pastor Tommy Creutz is back this weekend to bring God's Word to us. But I'm wondering, this is a discussion we've had in our small group, what is God teaching you about prayer in this series? So maybe you can take a few minutes right now and put that in the chat or put it in the comments. It'd be a great encouragement to other people to hear, you know, what God is teaching you. It might be something that challenges or encourages them. But either way, just let us know what God is teaching you through Teach Us to Pray.
Well, looking forward to seeing what you post. And I'd like to invite all of you to stand and join me as we begin our worship together.
Good morning, Harvest. Can we just continue to prepare our hearts right now to worship Him? Psalm 150, verse 6 says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. So if you have breath today, you have a reason to praise Him. Let's begin to prepare our hearts. Come on. Prepare your heart to praise Him today. Go.
And let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We see your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and we claim our being.
Come on.
And let it rise. Let praise. Let praise arise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Cause we cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With our creation cry, God, we praise you. Say, whoa. kisses, but heaven sounds like we praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. Lift up your worship. We praise you, Jesus. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. So we praise you. One more time, say it. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is the heaven now. We praise you. We praise you. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. If you cannot survive when we praise you, then God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high with our creation cry. We'll see you break down every wall. Yeah. We'll watch the giants fall down right in front of us. Yeah.
As we continue in worship, I just want to say welcome. My name is John Smith. I'm the co-campus pastor here at Rolling Meadows Campus, and this is my wife, Sherry.
And I want to add a word of welcome to you as well. I especially want to welcome our first-time guest. If this is the first time you've joined us at Harvest Online, we're really glad you're here. And for everyone, whether you're new or you've watched every week we've been online, we'd like to invite you to check in. You can do that on the website right here. You can do it in the comments on the YouTube or Facebook. You can also do it on the app, but it lets us know that you're here, and it gives us a way to pray for you if you'll share a prayer request on there.
Well, earlier this week, you received an email announcement letting you know that we have a transition taking place of two of our pastors, Pastor Greg Bradshaw, Pastor Ed Ollie, and also some updated information about our lead teaching pastor. And so if you haven't had a chance to look at that, you can go to harvestnow.info and take a look at that. But you know, as I've been processing this information this week, it's been hard. I think it's been a lot to take in, and sometimes I'm sad, sometimes I feel the loss. But in this process, and I just want to be reminded of who these men are, it's been a privilege to serve alongside of them and for them. With Pastor Greg, man, he's been here for 17 years, faithfully serving the Lord. And, you know, as I was talking to different people on staff, as I talk with people in our congregation, there's a word that stands out to me about who Pastor Greg is, and it's faith. Man, I've just seen how he has grown in the Lord over the years and how his dependence and his leaning into the Lord. And, you know, I love that series, Just Jesus. And I think that's kind of like what he is all about. He's trying to be just a representative of just Jesus in his life. And his faith has grown. I know that he has spent time in the Word and in prayer. And the way that he has led us has just been so amazing. And I'm so grateful for him and for all that he has poured into my life. And it's been great.
And with Pastor Greg leaving, that means that his wife, Chris, is leaving too. Chris and I have served Harvest as pastor's wives for a lot of years, but on different campuses, so we don't see each other that often. But one of the things I will always know about Chris is she's really a wise woman. She's a student of God's Word, and she lives out what God's Word says. Even in talking to some women from her campus, they would also say she's so genuine. It's a great quality that she has of being very authentic, and you don't have to be with her for very long before you see that. So we will definitely miss Pastor Greg and Chris, and we're grateful for all that they've poured into our church for the Lord.
Yeah, so thankful for them. Pastor Ed Ollie, man, I think of him. I just remember the first time I met him, walked into a room, and there he was, and he stood up, big smile on his face, and gave me that bear hug. And you know, from that time on, that's always been the greeting, a big smile, a welcome, And it's because there's something that's in his spirit. It's the joy of the Lord. And that's where he gets his strength. And that's what I've observed in him as he's led our campus pastors, as he has preached the word, as he has so faithfully tried to serve the Lord with everything he has. What I see standing out in his life is the joy of the Lord.
And what is Ed without Marcia?
Yeah.
If you know one, you know the other. And I just feel like the time is so short with Marcia. It was a year ago this weekend, Marcia and Diane Learned and a whole group of great people from the Cathedral campus, we worked at a water station along the Chicago Marathon route. And we really got to know each other a little bit that day and then some other things we've done together. And now the Lord's calling them to something else. But I know that when I think of Marcia, I think of someone who is very steady. Her confidence is in Christ, and she's steady, and she's very stable, and just brings a lot of wisdom to all those around her. And she's a great helpmeet for Pastor Ed.
Well, both these families are going to be greatly missed. And as you process it, like I have been this week, we need to go to the anchor. We need to go to the rock. We need to go to the one who can give us hope. We need the one who can give us peace and comfort. And a couple of verses that I found to be really helpful this week, and they've been found in Isaiah 26, verses 3 and 4. And it says, "You keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord God is an everlasting rock." I'd just like to pray for these families as they leave. Thankful for them, and then just pray for our church. So, dear Father, thank you so much for being the everlasting God. Thank you for being the one who is never shaken. You are our refuge. You are our strength. You wrap your arms around us. You care for us. And as a church, Lord, we need you right now. We need your presence to fill us. We need your provision for us. And we just pray that you would continue to be everything that we need as we lean in, and we know that you will never fail us, you will never leave us, you will always guide us, and you will always guard us. And I pray for these families as they leave, that you would be their provision, that you would be providing for them in a way that they've maybe never seen before, that their dependence, that they're leaning in, that you would show them what it is that you have for them. We ask that you'll just bless them and keep them. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have just two more quick announcements. One of those is we have a new class that we've never offered before. It's called How to Study the Bible Seriously for Men and Women. And it starts at the end of October, and you can get all the information at harvestnow.info. But it's really designed for every adult from every campus. It's going to meet in person at the Rolling Meadows campus, kind of a central location. And it's really designed for you if you want to have more tools in your toolbox as you study God's Word. It's a great tool to equip you just for your own personal study or if you're studying for something else. But I hope that you get signed up today at harvestnow.info.
Well, before we stand and worship in song, I just want to really encourage you to continue being faithful in the way that you have been giving over this last season, whether it's online or texting or through the mobile app or sending it in through the mail. Just thank you so much for your continued faithfulness to our church. So let's stand to our feet and worship the Lord.
I know. Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree.
Yeah.
His body bound and dressed in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah sealed and all.
Oh,
praise the Son. And praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son. And praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise, we praise You, Lord. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son. And praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him.
Everybody,
oh, praise Him. Alleluia.
Glory.
Alleluia.
Glory.
Alleluia. Amen.
Alleluia.
Praise You, Lord.
Glory to the Lamb.
God, we lift that up to You. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, Lord. All that we are is because of You. And God, we've come to this place to be more like You, to be more like Your Son, Jesus Christ. We've worshiped Him in spirit and in truth. Lord, we ask that You would speak through Pastor Tommy. Might Your Spirit impact us. Might it penetrate our hearts and make us more like You. It's in the strong name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.
Well, hey, church, can I just say that I am thankful for the Word of God on weeks like this week and months like this month and years like this year, that no matter the uncertain circumstances in my life or in those around me, we have the Word of God to comfort our hearts, to teach us about God's character, and to provide for us in ways that we never thought possible. And so I'm excited to be preaching today a message that I've been preaching to myself all week. And it has comforted me, and it has encouraged me, and I hope that it does the same for you. But before we dive in, just a little story. You know, back in my 20s, before I was married and before I had kids, I liked to do some more extreme types of sports. Kelly doesn't let me do them anymore because I always tend to get hurt. And so, thank God for a good wife. Amen? Right. But before her, I was a little extreme, okay? I was a little extreme, and one of the extreme sports that I loved to do was rock climbing, and I loved it. I started in college and really took to it, and I got kind of good at it. I watched videos and I read books. I kind of just tried to absorb as much information as I possibly could, and I loved it. I mean, I still have my rock climbing shoes and a chalk bag just in case. You know, I know we live in Illinois, but, you know, sometimes, you just never know. Don't tell Kelly about that, by the way, okay? If you're watching this, I'm sorry. It's always in the trunk of my car. And, you know, one time, my family, we decided to go to Arizona for a trip to visit my sister who was down there. And, you know, when we got down there, I thought, this is perfect. This is perfect. I could go and climb someplace awesome. And so I talked to my parents and my sister. I said, hey, listen, as a family, wouldn't it just be nice to gather as a family and maybe go as a family, hiking as a family? You know, nothing underneath that whatsoever. Maybe we could just go as a family together, right? And they're like, yeah, that's a great idea. I'm like, yes, let's go. Let's go. I'm going to find something awesome to climb. And so lo and behold, we went out to hike and we came across this vertical wall, and it was kind of a switchback up this mountain, if you will, and it was perfect. And I turned to my family and I said, listen, can I go climb just really fast? You guys don't have to come with me. You can stay right here. And they're like, fine, go. Of course, my mom said, be careful. And so I went and I ran over to the rock and I started to climb. By the way, I didn't have a rope and I didn't have any chalk. And I also didn't have my shoes. So I was a little unprepared, but I was really excited. So I started climbing up this rock face, and things started, it was going pretty well. It looked like it was about 35 feet high, so I was pretty okay with that. And then I got about 35 feet up where I thought that the top was, and it wasn't the top. It just kind of went in a little bit. And so I'm like, oh, okay, I've got some more, you know, I've got some more wall to climb. And that worried me a little bit, just a small amount, but I was a pro at that point. So I'm like, okay, I can handle this. What's another 35 feet, right? So I start climbing even higher. And then at the top of this wall, it kind of comes out like a vertical overhang. And it was at that moment. By the way, that's kind of what it was like. That's not me. I don't know if you can tell by the biceps. That's not me at all. But it was like that, a vertical overhang. And as I was looking up at it, 75 feet in the air, I thought to myself, I'm in trouble. I am in trouble. And I knew that in that moment, without a rope, without anything, that I needed help. And I heard the voices of people walking on the path above me, and I started yelling. I started yelling and crying out for help while I was on this vertical wall. And can I just say that I feel like our prayer lives are that way sometimes. We don't pray until we are in a mess. We don't pray until we are at the end of ourselves. We don't pray until we don't have anything left. And so today, Jesus is going to teach us to pray a better way. He's going to continue to teach us to pray a better way. And so the title of today's message is, Lord, I Need You. What a fitting title for our time today spent in God's Word. Lord, I need you. And we're going to be in two passages today, and I want to give you both of them before we jump in. Our primary passage will be Matthew 6, verse 11, and then the other is going to be Exodus chapter 16. And these passages have quite a few parallels in them. And we'll be going back and forth between these two texts. And so if you have, you know, one of these fancy ribbons in your Bible, go ahead and place that in Exodus 16. If you have a bookmark or maybe a piece of paper, just put it in there, because we're going to be flipping back and forth pretty often. But we're in Matthew 6:11, and here's the text for us today. It's this: Give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. And we're going to be breaking this up into phrases. And the first thing that we're going to see in this is Lord, petition. Lord, petition. Give us this day our daily bread. If you remember from last week, there's a pivot happening in the prayer. It's going from adoration and exaltation and recognition of who God is as Father and as King and as Master. And now it transitions into the needs of us. Give us this day our daily bread. And so how do we do this? How do we bring our needs to God? Well, Jesus is teaching us here exactly how to do that through petition. Give us. A petition is to make or present a formal request to an authority. It means to formally ask. And Jesus is teaching us to ask God for the things that we need. Like children coming to their father to ask for their needs, we come to God and we ask for our needs. Lord, give us this day our daily bread. I'm going to use my two kids as an example here. The first one is Ava. She's our little girl. She's 1.5 years old. She's a cutie. And listen, she doesn't know how to talk yet. She knows how to make noises, and really, really loud noises at that. She doesn't know how to speak yet. She doesn't know how to verbally ask for the things that she needs. And so when she is upset and she's crying and she needs something, I always go down to her and I say, baby, I want to give you what you need. Tell me what you need. What do you need? What do you need right now? And she never responds. I don't know why I asked that question, but she never responds. She kind of just grunts and is still crying. But eventually she kind of catches on to what I'm saying to her, and she starts pointing and grunting. And then that way I can follow her finger of where she's pointing, and I can start to figure out exactly what she wants. Maybe it's milk, maybe it's a new diaper, which is a lot of the times, or maybe it's just to be closer to dad, which happens almost never, and it's really sad. But in that moment, I am so ready to give her exactly what she needs. I just need her to ask or to point. And God is so ready to give us what we need. He is so ready as our loving Father to give us what we need. We just need to ask, to petition to him. Now that's Ava. We also have Zion. Now Zion is 5 years old. That's a picture of him on his first day of kindergarten this year. And you can't read it, but one of those things on there is, when I grow up, I want to be like my daddy, which is like the sweetest thing in the entire world. But he added something at the end. He says, when I grow up, I want to be like my daddy, but stronger. Good luck, dude. Okay, daddy's always going to be stronger, okay? I love it. But he knows how to verbally ask for things. He's 5 years old, so he's old enough to be able to ask for things. But here's the thing. Even though he knows how to ask for things, it doesn't always come out as like a formal request. It doesn't always come out as a question. Sometimes it comes out as a statement. Dad, I'm hungry. And when he says that statement to me, I can kind of start figuring out what he wants. He's saying, I want something to eat. Can you get me something to eat, Dad? I'm hungry. Or he says, Dad, I'm not feeling good. And in that statement, I can kind of figure out that either his blood sugar is high or his blood sugar is low, or he's getting sick. But Dad, I'm bored. Dad, I'm bored. I can figure out the thing that he wants and needs in that moment is to have some fun, to play together. And sometimes it comes with a little tude, you know what I mean? A little attitude. He's like, oh, Daddy, I'm hungry. Of course, sometimes it comes with crying. And he says, Daddy, I'm hurt. But even through those statements and those emotions, I know what he needs, and I give it to him. And we see pretty clearly how God responds to this type of petition. Look over at Exodus 16. I hope you marked it in your Bible. We're going to go over to Exodus 16, and we're going to read. We're going to start in verse 1. It says this. They set out from Elim, and all the congregation of the people of Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had departed from the land of Egypt. And the whole congregation of the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the people of Israel said to them, "Would that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the meat pots and ate bread to the full, for you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." So the 15th day of the second month, so 2.5 months into the wilderness, and they were already grumbling. My goodness, how relatable is this? I mean, is this relatable or what? It is sometimes scary how much we are like the nation of Israel, right? Because some of us didn't last 2.5 days into lockdown before we started grumbling. Some of us started by 2.5 months. We started grumbling. Most people started grumbling, and we kind of said the same thing. I want to go back. I want to go back. I want to go see a movie again at a movie theater. I want to go back into work and not be interrupted by my kids every 3 seconds. I want to go back to the days where I can buy toilet paper in the store. Amen? I want to go back to the day where I could get a haircut in a barbershop or a hair salon. I want to go back to the day where I never have to use Zoom again. I want to go back to the day where I don't ever have to wear a mask. But then you have some serious ones. You have serious grumblings. I want to go back to when I had a job. I want to go back to when my business was open. I want to go back to when I could provide for my family. I want to go back to seeing people because I'm feeling lonely and depressed. I want to go back to when I could go to a funeral for a loved one and grieve properly. These are serious, serious grumblings. And the people of Israel, they had serious grumblings too. They were serious. The situation that they were in, they were hungry. They were so hungry that they were dreaming about going back to the day that they were slaves because at least they had food. And in all of that, even in the grumbling, we know that God answered their grumbling and provided later on in Exodus 16. He heard the request underneath the emotion. He heard the request inside of the grumbling. He heard the petition inside of the pity. And I don't know about you, but this gives me great encouragement. I hope it does give you encouragement as well, because here's the thing. God is capable of handling your emotions when you come and ask him something. God is capable of handling your emotions when you come to ask him something. We see this throughout all of the Psalms with David, and we see it here with Israel. The request was raw. It was emotional. Listen, never be afraid to come to God with your emotions. Never be afraid to come to God with your petition, even if you are emotional about it. He is able to handle and to hear your request. Come to him with your emotions and ask, Lord, give me this day my daily bread, like a child to their father. You know, I think that that's one of the things that keeps us from coming to God and asking him for our needs. We feel like we need to do it perfectly. Have you ever felt that way? Feel like you need to do it perfectly. I need to ask perfectly. We don't. We don't. We see that here. We just need to ask. We just need to ask. I think another stumbling block for us in coming to the Lord in petition is found in verse 8. Matthew 6, verse 8. It says, do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. He says, do not be like them. He's talking about the Gentiles who use many words. And he's saying, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. And so the question automatically comes up, well, if God knows what I need, then why do I need to pray? If God knows what I need, then why do I need to pray? He already knows. He is sovereign. He's in control of all of it. Why do I need to pray for my needs if he knows my needs? Won't he just give them to me? Well, here's why, even though God knows what I need, this is why we pray. Here's the first thing. Obedience. Obedience. God commands us to pray in his word. And there are many of examples of this in Scripture, and I'll just give you one. 1 Thessalonians 5:17. It says, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. That's a whole verse. This is a command. This is a command. God our Father, through his word, tells us to pray. So it's obedience. But then it's also transformation. Transformation. It changes me. When we pray, we are aligning our hearts with God. That changes us. It helps us to persevere. In Luke 18, verse 1, Jesus says, and he told them a parable to the effect that they ought to always to pray and to not lose heart. It nourishes our faith. It helps us to know God more. It strengthens my inner being. It changes us to trust in God and to surrender to him more. It's transformation. So it's obedience, it's transformation, and it's relationship. It's relationship. We have a relationship with God, and prayer builds my relationship with God. I mean, could you imagine not talking to someone you're in an intimate relationship with? Can you imagine that? Like, say, your wife or your husband or your best friend? How well would that go if you didn't communicate at all? It would probably go pretty poorly, right? It would go pretty bad. Prayer builds relationship with God, our Father. So Jesus teaches us here in this first phrase, he teaches us in the give us to petition. But then we see this. Here's the next thing that we see. I need perspective. I need perspective. This day, our daily. Give us this day, our daily bread. And maybe you thought like me when you read this for the first time. Give us this day our daily bread. Huh. Well, Jesus, that seems a little unnecessarily repetitive, like back to back, right? This day and daily. Yeah. I got it. And we like kind of gloss over that. But there is so much inside of those words that Jesus is trying to teach us. This day, which literally translates, give us today our bread. Give us today our bread. He is helping us to bring in the focus to today, to switch our perspective, to bring it into this day, today. And we see this again in Exodus 16, in the parallel, we see, it says in verse 4, then the Lord said to Moses, behold, I am about to rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, that I may test them, whenever or whether they will walk in my law or not. And on the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather daily. Go and gather a day's portion. Go and gather 2 days' portion. The Lord is providing and sustaining for Israel for the day and every day. He doesn't tell them to go out and gather a week's portion. He doesn't go out and tell them to store up a month's portion of bread or manna, as they call it. He says, gather for today. And in fact, later in the chapter, we see those who didn't trust God in this way, who tried to store up some for the next day. And it says that during the night, it immediately turned bad. It bred worms and it stank. And so God told them to gather all that they would need for the day to satisfy them completely. Give us this day our daily bread. This day. Listen, don't miss that. This day. Today. How are we to pray? Pray for today. Lord, would you sustain me today? This day. Because my mind and my heart are wont to wander into next week and into next month and into next year. What's going to happen in the next few weeks, Lord? What's going to happen in the next month, Lord? There's so much going on in our world, the election and COVID and my relationships and my job and my family and my finances and my business and my house and my kids and my spouse and in my church. How is this all going to work out? Will I be in the same situation next year? Is this going to get any better? Or what if this gets even worse? What if? And we spiral out of control. We become anxious and we become angry and we become worried and we become a hot mess. And I have felt this so much during this past year. God knows I have felt this. I've let my mind over the past year drift to the uncertain future and become filled with anxiety and fear and dread. But Jesus is teaching us to pray for today, to focus in on today. God, sustain me today. Provide all that I need this day, and I trust you with the future. In verse 34, it says, do not be anxious for tomorrow. Tomorrow will be anxious for itself. We need to focus in our perspective on this day. The less clear our perspective this day gets, the less clear our perspective of everything around it starts to get. Until everything from our perspective becomes unclear. It becomes out of focus. Now, when I'm out of focus, I'm lost. I can't make out anything around me. I can barely see anything around me. I can't see anything around me. I can't even see today anymore. I'm so lost and I'm disoriented. So focus your perspective in on this day. Focus your perspective in on this day. God, this day, give me what I need. God, this day, today, sustain me. How powerful is that? How simple is that? And when we pray like this every day, imagine how this could change your prayer life. Imagine what this could do for your emotional life. Imagine what this could do for your mental life and your physical health. And imagine what it could do for your spiritual life. Trusting in God every day just for the day. Just for today. How could that change our anxiety and our fear and our dread of the future? Praying every moment, God, sustain me for this day. God, sustain me for this day. And I don't just stop praying this, you know, I don't pray it one time and then stop. One day I pray it and then it's over. I'm praying that today. And then tomorrow, I'm going to be praying the same thing. And then the next day, I'm going to be praying the same thing. When I wake up, I'm going to be praying, give us this day our daily bread every day. And I would encourage you to do that, church. Every morning you wake up, First thing, as verse 33 says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. When you wake up, have this be a part of your morning prayer. God, sustain me for this day. And that takes us to the last point and the last word. The last point being you, provision. You, provision. And the last word being bread. Give us this day our daily bread. Well, I may have already given away what the bread means with the point, but I'll unpack that just a little bit more. This is what Jesus is teaching us. He's teaching us that the thing that we need to petition for this day is bread. And the word bread here is a synecdoche, which is a figure of speech in which a part is made to represent the whole. A synecdoche. I know that looks like a weird word, but that is how you say it. And it's referring to the bread here. And the bread is the part that is made to represent the whole. And so we're not just praying for bread. We're not just praying only for bread. You know, sometimes we pray for pizza. Amen. I'm just kidding. That's a terrible joke. Listen, bread is the part. Bread is the part. And it's standing in for the whole. It's representing food and the basic things that we need in life. This is provision. Provision. The things we will need throughout the day. And I think the end of Matthew chapter 6 sums this up really well for us. Look at verse 25. It says this, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or where you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? I love that. And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat and what shall we drink or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. God is our provider. He is our provision for the basic things that we need in life, for our daily needs. Look at Exodus 16 one more time. Verse 35, right at the end there. It says, the people of Israel ate the manna 40 years till they came to a habitable land. God provided for his people every day for 40 years. He is faithful to do it. He is trustworthy. He has proven this over and over and over, and he provides for you. He is your provision. And this isn't just the physical provision either. Clothes, food, drink, shelter. It's also provision in the less tangible needs. God doesn't just provide for us physically. He provides for us emotionally, physically, practically, relationally. He provides all I need for the day in my emotions. He provides all that I need for the day in my relationships. He provides all that I need for the day in practical ways by giving us supernatural grace and supernatural patience and supernatural comfort and strength and so on. He provides. He is our provision. And probably most important of all, and I don't want you to miss this, he has provided and has already met our greatest spiritual need, that of salvation and redemption through his Son, Jesus Christ. You know, in John 6, Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. And they said to him, sir, give us this bread always. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Jesus is the bread of life, and he never spoils, and he never goes rotten, and he always sustains us completely. So when we are asking God to give us our daily bread, we are asking God to give us Jesus, to be the provision for us physically, yes. To be the provision for us mentally, yes. To emotionally, yes. Practically, yes. But more than all of that, spiritually. Being the provision for us spiritually. God is my provision. And when we ask God for our daily bread, we are in humility acknowledging him as the sole giver of everything that we need. We are living day by day, this day, a step at a time, and we are practicing simple faith in him to provide exactly what we need, exactly when we need it, for every area of our life. He is our provision. And so to end, I want to go back to the beginning. I want to go back to the beginning, back to rock climbing. I was in trouble. I was in big trouble. I needed help. My life was in danger. And I called out for help. I screamed for help. And luckily, the people walking on the path above me heard my cries. And as I reached my hand over top of this overhang, they grabbed onto me and they pulled me up over that last bit of rock. And I got up and I thought to myself, wow, I really needed help there. Obvious, right? Like, that wasn't smart to do by myself, without any gear, unprepared. That was not a smart thing. But the thing was is that I thought that I only needed help right there at the end, right there in the most difficult part. But the reality is I needed help the entire time. I needed help the whole time. The difficult part on the wall was always there. I just didn't see it. I didn't see it. And there were multiple other parts on the wall where if I made a mistake, I would have been injured or worse. I needed help the entire time. And so to those of us who pray only when things are a mess, only pray when we are at the end of ourselves, when we only pray when we see no path forward, only pray when we see clearly that we are in need of provision because it is all run out, the reality is that we need God's provision every day, every hour, every second of our life. And I know that we think that we can do it ourselves, that we have the strength to make it through, that we are capable enough, but we aren't. We can't make it even a day without the Lord's provision. And we think that we are in need only when things go really, really bad, and that's when we pray. But the truth is that you are in need every day. You need provision from the Lord every day. Give us this day our daily bread. So let our prayer lives change. Lord, I need you. I come to you in petition. I need a fresh perspective to focus in on this day. Lord, help me not for my mind to wander to the future. You control that, Lord. Would you sustain me for today? Lord, I need you. You are my provision. You are my provider. So let's petition to the Lord. Let's have a renewed perspective for today. And let's receive the provision that God has for us and the provision that Jesus Christ is for us. Give us this day our daily bread. Would you pray with me? God, we come before you as your children. You are our Father. You are a good Father. Lord, we come before you humbly in submission to you who are our King. Lord, we ask this, Lord. Give us this day, today. Give us what we need. Provide for us, Lord, today. trust you with tomorrow and next week and next month and next year. But Lord, would you provide today for us physically, emotionally, mentally, and most of all, Lord, spiritually. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the bread of life. Thank you for your provision, Lord. You are faithful. You never let us down, and you never will. We look to you as our provision. Lord, I need you. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, I think it's so fitting as we're teaching on Jesus being the bread of life that we would be remembering the Lord in communion today. The taking of the bread, which is his body given for us, unleavened and without sin, pierced and striped for our transgressions. And the taking of the wine, his blood poured out for us to cover our sin and redeem us so we could be in relationship with God. So why don't you go ahead and grab the elements as we remember together and as we reflect on our own lives. And we will take them together after the worship team sings over us.
Oh, how could it be that my God would welcome me into this mystery? Say, take this bread, take this wine as a symbol of the price for any who believe. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you, and remembrance leads us to worship. As we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We remember you.
For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Well, church, it's so good to remember Jesus together in communion and worship together and to hear from God's word. So I hope you have a wonderful week. Just know this. You are loved.